ప్రపన్న పారిజాతాయ తోత్ర వేత్రైకపాణయే జ్ఞానముద్రాయ కృష్ణాయ గీతామృత దుహే నమః. ఓం. డియర్ ఫ్రెండ్స్, వి ఆర్ సీయింగ్ దిస్ భగవద్గీత. ఇన్ ద లాస్ట్ ఎపిసోడ్ వీ కంప్లీటెడ్ వట్ ఈస్ కాల్డ్ భక్తి యోగ, ద చాప్టర్ ఆన్ డివోషన్. అండ్ దెన్ దట్ చాప్టర్ వీ డిస్కస్డ్ ఇన్ గ్రేట్ డీటెయిల్. వీ నీడ్ నాట్ గోయింగ్ టు దాట్ బికాస్ ఇట్ ఈస్ ఎ ఫెయిర్లీ ఈజీ చాప్టర్ ఆల్సో. Now we are coming to another chapter called Kshetra Kshetrajna Vibhaga Yoga. This is somewhat like a hard nut. When we take Gita, this is a slightly hard nut. So I will slowly explain it. So we have seen in the whole structure of Gita, right from the beginning, if we have seen the structure of Gita, I think I told once or twice that this structure, it is so structured that it is conveying the meaning of a Mahavakya of the Upanishad. Mahavakya in Upanishad means something which talks about the equation of the Jiva with Ishvara, or Jiva with the ultimate Parabrahma, as we call it. Jiva is essentially of the same nature as Brahma. So that is what, there are certain statements in the Upanishads, because they say what Upanishads say is that this Jiva essentially, his essential nature is the same as that of the Supreme Reality. So that is what it says, and such statements are called Mahavakyas, because it is telling a great truth. So this Gita is actually conveying that truth in its very structure. So that is what some commentators have pointed out. In the first 6 chapters, we have seen that there are 18 chapters in Gita, and in the 18 chapters, the first 6 chapters, it is telling the nature of the Jiva, Tvam Padartha. For example, there is a statement called Tat Tvam Asi. Tat means that means the Supreme Reality. Tvam means you, Asi means you are that. So that is what it says. And who is that you, Tvam Padartha? So the Tvam Padartha Vivechanam, that is analysis of what exactly is a Jiva, what is his, what exactly are the constituents in him. So that particular aspect has been explained in the third, the first 6 chapters. And the next 6 chapters, they told about the Tat Padartha. Tat means the Supreme Reality. So initially it talked about Jiva, and then the next 6 chapters, they talked about the Tat Padartha. So that is what we have seen. And the next 6 chapters, they talk about this equation, what we call the equation between the Jiva with the Supreme Reality. So that is what we see in this the next 6 chapters. So that is the reason why the next 6 chapters, they are called the Sadhana Shatkam. Sadhana means a spiritual quest, a spiritual exercise, a spiritual practice. That is what is sadhana. So we are doing a sort of spiritual, we are seeing different types of spiritual practices here. So the spiritual practices, of course, we have seen a little bit even earlier. For example, Karma Yoga is that. Atma Samyama Yoga is also that, and then Dhyana Yoga is also that, Bhakti Yoga is also a little bit in the same thing. Then what is the difference? So there you have done something which is physically and slightly intellectually, but here again, in this particular, from here on, it is actually a sort of internalization of what all has been told earlier. Consciously practicing whatever has been told. And that sort of practice is being told here in these chapters. And then in this first, this 13th chapter itself, in the very beginning, it is talking about how one has to look at oneself. That is, I look at myself as the body-mind complex, and I think that this is my personality. My personality means there is a social identity for me, that I am so and so. I belong to a particular social group. I belong to a particular religion, I belong to a particular country, I am educated in this particular way. So this is all my social identity. So all this social identity, that has to be kept aside. So that is what we see here. And how you have to look at your own self, how you have to observe your own self, how to make the body-mind complex itself as something which is in the field of observed. So here we come across two words called the observer and the observed. In Vedanta, we come across two words, that is observer and the observed. In the entire universe, if we see, there are only two things. That is, one is something which is seen or observed, something which is known by the known by intelligence, and the knower, that is the intelligence. Intelligence or sentient thing is one thing. and the insentient and something which is known, which is observed. So, that is another thing. So, these two are the things. So, broadly speaking, the meaning of these two words, this kshetra and kshetrajna is the same. That is, kshetra is something which is seen, which is observed, which is known, and kshetrajna is the knower, knower of the kshetram, knower of the observer. He is the conscious entity or the chit, as we call it in Vedanta. So, broadly this is the structure. And then now I will try to explain these two, this actual word kshetra. What is the meaning of kshetram? Usual we know that there is, suppose there is an agricultural field. This agricultural field is called kshetram. That is a common, I think this is a word which is there, it is a Sanskrit word which is there in almost all Indian languages. Kshetram is field. Kshetrapalaka, suppose we say Kshetrapalaka is somebody who is tending to that particular field, who is attending on that field. Then Kshetrajna is the person who knows that field. The etymological meaning of Kshetra is explained by commentators. Kshetra is Kshatat Trayate iti Kshetram. Kshatat Trayate means, now I am giving the meaning in advance. We are referring to the body-mind complex as the Kshetram, as I said. And this body-mind complex, if it is a kshetram, this is kshatat trayate means it is actually saving us or protecting us from falling into some sort of naraka, narakadi lakshanat trayate. That is, it is enabling you to do some good karma and elevate yourself. That is, the body-mind complex itself is the sadhanam either for one's downfall or for one's spiritual progress. So, you can actually do some adharmic things and then go in the downward trend. That is, there can be a downfall in a person, or a person can conduct himself in a proper way and then he can go to a higher level. So, that is the reason why this body or kshetram is called, it is called kshetram in the sense that kshatat trayate. It protects you, it saves you from having a downfall, and it enables you to go to a higher level. Then it is also called kshetram. There another derivation is kshiyate iti kshetram. Kshiyate iti kshetram, that is something which decays, which is not permanent, something which is decaying. Then another meaning is interesting, that is kshetravat karma phalam dadati. Kshetram, you know, you have got a field, then you cultivate that land, you sow some seeds, and whatever seeds you sow, it gives some fruit. So, like a kshetram, this body-mind complex also gives some fruit, and you perform some karma, you are getting some karma phalam. So, in that sense also it is kshetram. So, this karma phalam dadati, that is the reason why it is called kshetram. So, this is what we see in the very first shloka of this 13th chapter. So, this 13th chapter, as I said, slightly we have to understand these few words, that is the only problem. So, the whole chapter is from Lord Krishna to Arjuna. Krishna is starting this say shloka. Idam shariram kaunteya kshetramityabhidhiyate etadyo vetti tam prahuhu kshetrajna iti tadvidaha. That is the shloka. Idam shariram, on this particular shloka commentators have written huge things, about 10 to 15 pages. If I have to say all that, it will take about 15 episodes. And nobody will be interested in listening to all that. So, I will very briefly say the meaning. In fact, if you really want to know that, you can go to a website where I have taught the entire Bhashyam for about 10 to 15 hours. Website is advaita-academy.org. Advaita-academy.org. If you go to that website and look into that, there I have explained every word of that particular Bhashyam for about 10 hours. Because it takes about 10 hours, because there is so much of discussion there, a lot of philosophical discussion about various arguments and counter arguments by various philosophical schools. Because these commentators, they belong to various periods of time. For example, Shankaracharya is a person who belonged to some late 7th century or early 8th century. So, he wrote very elaborate commentary, and all the contemporaneous doctrines or theories, they have been examined by him. And what all the theories were there. His problem was, on one hand, to say cut down or rather put down rather the Mimamsakas who were hardcore ritualists, who were very much interested in karma, who were emphasizing only on karma and not much on jnana. And then his other job was also to counter the Buddhists who were advocating nihilism. So on one hand, one extreme is nihilism, the other extreme is too much of ritualism. So these two extremes he was countering, and Shankaracharya, we can say it was a sort of middle path. So that is what we can say. So, but anyway, I will, somebody who is interested in that, he may look into that, but now I will very briefly explain. So, here idam shariram, when we say idam, when I say this idam, this I call it, this is a pen, suppose. When I say this, this is not me, this is something which is apart from me. This is the first thing we know by the word idam. Idam means something, it is not me, it may be mine, but it is not me. Idam shariram kaunteya, when you say that this shariram, then it is, you are actually looking at it, you are distancing it, you are objectifying it. So that is what we see here, idam shariram kaunteya. And when we say when we use the word shariram in Vedanta, we use two types of sharira, if not three: sthula sharira, sukshma sharira, if not karana sharira. Karana sharira also comes into picture. Sthula sharira is this gross body, then this mind and intelligence, that is what we call the sukshma sharira, and karana sharira is the cause for these two, which is called the prakriti or maya. So these three things, so this whole thing Krishna is going to say that all this is kshetram. It comes under the category of kshetram. It can be dissociated from your real identity. Whatever can be dissociated from your real identity is what is kshetram. So idam shariram kaunteya kshetram ityabhidhiyate etadyo vetti. Vetti means one who knows. Knows means what? Vishayikaroti, that is one who makes the whole thing as an object for your knowledge. This is an object for my knowledge. When I make it an object for my knowledge, I use the word vishayikaroti, that is I am distancing this from me. So this whole kshetram, I have to distance it from me. Tam prahuhu kshetrajna iti tadvidaha. So this is the person who can identify, who can distinguish, who can dissociate himself from this particular thing and then realize his real nature. So that is what is kshetrajna. Who is the knower of this kshetra, knower of this field, is called kshetrajna. So let us recall what exactly we have seen. Of course, I will read the next shloka also and then explain. Kshetrajnyan chapi mam vidhi sarva kshetreshu bharata. That is, he says, hey Bharata, sarva kshetreshu, in all the body mind, in all these kshetras, that is in all the so called body mind complexes, kshetrajnyam mam vidhi, there is only one kshetrajnya, there is only one knower, there is only one consciousness, that is what he is driving at. The consciousness is something with the chit or chaitanyam or consciousness is one and the same in all these things. Sarva kshetreshu bharata. And then kshetra kshetrajnayor jnanam yat tad jnanam matamama. This knowledge of this kshetra and kshetrajna, this distinction of kshetra and kshetrajna, this analysis of kshetra and kshetrajna is the real knowledge. So that is what he says. Now let us see, let us go back and see what exactly we learnt earlier also. In the 7th chapter we have seen two words called para prakriti and apara prakriti. Para is the highest thing, that is the sentient aspect of it, the knower aspect of it. Apara is bhumihi, apaha, analo, vayuhu, kam, mano, buddhirevacha, etc., etc., if you recall what we saw in that 7th chapter. So there he was talking about apara prakriti, he was referring to all these panchamahabhutas, etc., etc. So that is apara prakriti. What he called apara prakriti is the kshetram. And what he called para prakriti there is kshetrajna, that is the consciousness principle. So if we see, if we just recall what all words which we saw earlier, for this particular word kshetram is the same as prakriti, and it is the same as what we saw as apara in 7th chapter. And this is also what can be called a vishaya. Vishaya means something which is an object. Vishayi is something which is the knower of an object. There are two words called vishaya and vishayi. Vishaya is an object and vishayi is the knower of that object. So this kshetra is a vishaya, and it is also a drushya. Drushya means something which is known, the knower and the known, the knower versus the known. And also this is something which is anatma. Anatma means it is something which is the non-self, it is not me. The real self is something different. And this is also called jada, is something which is insentient. And kshetrajna in contrast, it is called purusha, prakriti and purusha. Purusha, prakriti and purusha are actually two terms which have been used by the Sankhya philosophers, but which have been accepted into Vedanta. This I have, you know, with a slight difference, not totally accepted in the same way as they described it, in a slightly different way they have been used in Vedanta also. Not accepted, they are used in Vedanta, I should correct myself. So, this Purusha is the sentient entity. Then this is also called the Para, and this is also called the Druk. Druk, Druk means the seer, and Drushyam, Druk versus Drushyam. And then this is the Atma, or rather this is the real nature of self. So, this is what we see here in this particular, say these two shlokas. Kshetrajnyan chapi mam vidhi means, what does it mean? You know that I am also the Kshetrajnya. So, what does it mean? I am already something, I am also that. Suppose I say, I am also holding some charge of some place, let us say, which means that I am already in charge of something, I am also in charge of that. So, what is it? Kshetrajnyan chapi mam vidhi, the commentators have pointed out, that whatever you are calling as a kshetram, that is also not something which is different from that. Then what is this contradictory statement? Just now we have seen that there is kshetram is something different and kshetrajna is something different. And in the very next shloka, Krishna is saying kshetra kshetrajna yor jnana kshetrajnyan chapi mam vidhi. What is it that he is saying? There the commentators have pointed out that in reality there is only this thing called consciousness. And in that consciousness only, whatever this world which is appearing as a phenomena, this phenomenal world is appearing in that consciousness. So, this is what commentators have said. And this is exactly where we come very, very close to what physics also says. The point here is, even now, the scientists are not able to decide or finally tell us whether intelligence is something which is produced from the matter or these two are totally independent and independently existing, or whether there is only one principle called consciousness, which is there, in which there is something which is happening, which we do not know. In that consciousness, that is, that itself is appearing as matter. This is the place where a lot of research is going on, a sort of multidisciplinary research is going on. So, anyway, I am not qualified in talking about quantum physics or anything. People who know quantum physics, they talk a lot about these things. In fact, there is a website called something relating to non-duality and science or something like that. There is a website where lot many scientists, they are writing about this non-duality. So, that is something which is interesting, non-duality and science. So, here what we see is Kshetrajnyan chapi mam vidhi means I am also the Kshetra. And I am also the real Kshetrajna. That is, my real nature is Kshetrajna, and the appearance or the phenomena is also nothing different from me. So, that is what it means. And then while coming back to what we talked about, the equation between the Jiva and the Ishvara. So, when we say that Jiva is the same as Paramatma, the Supreme Reality, then how are we going to make that equation? That is again an important thing. So, here of course, the commentators have written quite a lot. So, I will try to explain in brief. When I say Paramatma or Supreme Reality, what does it mean? The Supreme Reality is something which is Sarvajna, Sarveshwara, Sarvashaktimat, all these things are there. Sarvajna is something which is what we call in English as omniscient, Sarveshwara, omniscient, omnipotent, etc. And then what else? Sarva Shaktimat, etc., etc. And then when we talk, and also all pervading, that is Ananta, that all pervading. So, that is what is the nature of Paramatma. And what is the nature of Jiva? Jiva is, his essential nature may be Antahkaranavachinnam Chaitanyam, as I have told several times. That is, when we are referring to a particular entity called Jiva, we are also referring to the Chaitanya aspect of him plus the gross aspect of him. There is what is called Chit and also Jada, which are seen in him. So that is antahkarana aspect is there, the antahkarana vachinna chaitanyam is there. In addition to that, kinchignyatva, kinchit, God, the supreme reality is sarvajna. In contrast to sarvajna, he is kinchit. Kinchit means a little. Kinchit, kinchignyaha, and he is not all powerful, he is having very little power. So, it is such a great contrast. It is somewhat like a contrast between a mountain and a small, say, atom. So, but mountain and atom, in essence, they are one and the same. Mountain also consists of atoms, and this atom also is of the same material. So, that way, the equation is slightly metaphorical in the sense that, say, they use a particular, say, strategy called lakshana. It is called lakshana. So, lakshana means it is a technical word. So, for example, a word can have different levels of meaning. One is a literal meaning. A literal meaning is what is called vachyartha. Vachyartha means something which is expressed as it is, vachyartha. And there is what is called figurative meaning. It is a figurative lakshyartha. Suppose I say a standard example which is given is, say there is a village in the river, suppose Gangayam Ghoshaha, let us say, a village in the river Ganges. A village cannot be in the Ganges. But then the meaning we take is, the village is so proximate, so close to Ganges, that it is something which is called village in the Ganges. So, that means you are taking a slightly metaphorical meaning for that expression, village in the Ganges. So, like that there is what is called lakshana. Lakshana is a slightly metaphorical meaning, where the literal meaning does not fit in. So, here when you are saying that tat tvam asi, that jiva is the same as Brahman, you can't challenge saying that, okay, if you are Brahma, you create this pen, or if you are Brahma, you create this cell phone or something like that. We are not talking from that point of view. In fact, Vedanta says there is no such thing as a creator, somebody who is creating the entire thing. It is only a phenomena which is happening. It is a phenomena which is happening in this entire, say, consciousness, in the whole ocean of consciousness. This is a phenomena which is happening. This is something strange. In fact, Vedanta, it shatters all our, say, biases. It shatters all our opinions about our own ideas of various God, etcetera, etcetera, our own ideas about religion. Religion is a very important tool, an important tool for knowing this ultimate thing. Religion is an important tool to go beyond religion. So, that is what we say. So, here what we see is, this lakshyartha is equated. If you take away this sarvajnyatva, kinchignyatva, what remains is pure consciousness. And if you take away this kinchignyatva of jiva and then take only the essential nature called consciousness, so that consciousness is the same as that supreme reality. So, that is what we see. So, there this particular angle only is equated, and that is how we say that this jiva is essentially not different from Brahma. So, when we say that jiva, Brahmaikyam, it is not a very arrogant statement. It is not a statement which says this fellow is such an idiotic fellow, he is calling himself Brahma. It is not like that. He is calling himself as Aham Brahmasmi is something which is not an egotistical statement. It is a statement where this Aham is totally eradicated. Aham is totally eradicated and it is totally merged in that supreme reality, in that say supreme consciousness. So, that is what we see here. And then it goes on like that, and then we will continue in the say next episode. Tat kshetram yachya yadruksha yadvikari yatashet. Krishna is going to say, what is the nature of the kshetram? What are the constituents? What are all these things? And then after that, he does not talk directly about kshetrajna, he talks about what is called jnanam. And what are the constituents of that jnanam? He also is going to say, we will see that in the next episode. Harihi Om Tat Sat.